Hello students of class 7th. I'll welcome you all in your revision class of your GK book. And in today's revision class, we are going to start with chapter 5, that is traditional art form of India. So children, today we are going to revise about traditional art form of India. Although we have finished the whole book of GK and this practice of this chapter also you have done. So today in revision we'll do about traditional art forms of India. Now what do we mean by traditional? Traditional means which began many years ago, which is not a new one. Means the thing which is continuing from before 100 years, 200 years, that will become tradition from a respective place. If I talk about different painting, different art and architecture of different states, so they were following all these art and architecture from many years ago, and that will become and that are forming a tradition of that particular place. So today we are going to continue with this note. We are going to start with this traditional art form of India. Now here we are going to talk about painting, drawing and these kind of art form. So first of all, identify these traditional styles of painting from India with the help of the given clues. Now clues have been given and by reading out the clues you have to identify that which traditional form of this is there. Now this style of painting flourished in Gujarat during the 18th century. What I have told you just now, that traditional means which is going on there from many years ago. From many years ago and from many earlier time it is going on. So that is your traditional art form. This painting or this style of painting that we are talking about, that flourished in Gujarat during the 18th century. Now it is noted for its variety, clarity and use of rich color. Now it was the influence of a Chinese art also. You can see that Chinese picture, Chinese kind of a structure will be forming inside that painting. Chinese rich color, it was the influence of a Chinese artist that made it very popular across the region. But this style of painting revolves around the brightly colored glasses of different pattern. So basically this kind of embroidery will be done by using glass mirror and they were putting it and then they were doing this kind of embroidery. Mostly that kind of embroidery is used on chanya choli and that lehenga. So what is the name of this painting that you can see the answers also, that is Worli. Worli painting. Fine, Worli folk painting also sometime it is called. And what is the variety or what is the quality of this painting? That it is brightly colored. See, if you were seen chanya choli and that kind of a dance, you just find it out that they were wearing multicolored or brightly colored dresses. So that is one among that, worldly one. Now we'll come to next. It is one of the most well-known forms of tribal arts, both at the national and international levels. It is named after a tribe that lives in the mountainous as well as the coastal areas of Maharashtra, Gujarat border. So this is a well-known form of tribal art. What do you mean by tribal art? Tribal means tribal people are those people, those who were using very less resources from the urban areas. They were living in jungle and forest, and they were utilizing most of the resources from that. Jungle and all. So that is they are known as tribal people, and this kind of a people we will be getting in coastal areas also of Maharashtra and Gujarat border. So, because they are rich in forest, on the seashore we will get many forest and jungle type of a structure will be there, and this kind of a painting will be formed over there. Now, this tribal art is known as glass. This tribal art is known as glass. Now we'll come to next. It is a style of Indian painting practiced in the Mithila region of Bihar. Now, Mithila is quite famous at the time of Ashoka, Chandragupta Maurya. Now, Mithila region of Bihar, it is very popular. It is equally popular in some parts of Nepal also. Now, this painting is created with fingers, with your hand fingers, twigs, means dhatun jo hota hai, twigs, brushes, nib pens and matchstick. इन सारी चीज़ों से ये पेंटिंग बनाई जाती थी. अर्लियर इफ यू वेंट टू विलेज और सम प्लेसेस लाइक दैट, तो यू विल फाइंड इट आउट दैट दे वर डूइंग पेंटिंग यूजिंग स्टिक्स एंड ऑन द वॉल ओनली दे वर डूइंग दैट पेंटिंग. डिफरेंट थिंग्स विल बी पेंटेड ओवर देयर एंड उसके ऊपर पेंट करने के बाद एंड दे विल बी ब्राइटली कलर्स. So they use natural dyes and pigments, like instead of yellow color they will use haldi, instead of black color they will use something which we will be getting from our household natural dyes. Now geometrical pattern are mostly used in this style of painting. So what kind of a pattern they were used in this kind of a painting, that is Madhubani. ये पेंटिंग का नाम क्या है? द नेम ऑफ द पेंटिंग इज मधुबनी. मधुबनी एंड इट इज़ क्वाइट फेमस पेंटिंग फ्रॉम मिथिला रीजन. और वो लोग क्या करते थे? देवर इंटरप्रेट डिफरेंट इंस्टेंस, मीन्स द थिंग्स विच विल बी हैपनिंग एवरी डे. लाइक द गर्ल्स दे आर गोइंग फॉर वाटर, ऑब्वियसली एवरी डे देवर गोइंग फॉर वाटर. देन समबडी हु इज पासिंग बाय ओवर देयर, अगेन यस obviously that if one road is there that somebody will be passing over there, so that you will do it. Now two famous painters of India, Saeed Haider Raza and Maqbool Fida Hussain. The short name of Maqbool Fida Hussain, that is MF Hussain, and he has got for this art and architecture he has got many awards, many prizes. One of the famous painter of India, that is MF, Maqbool Fida Hussain. Maqbool Fida Hussain. So now we'll come to next page of this painting. It is a traditional painting of Odisha, number 4. It is a traditional painting of Odisha. The painting of this art form are specially inspired by Jagannath Temple of Puri. Now this painting is done on canvas which is prepared using a mixture of chalk and gum with tamarind seeds. Now the colors used in the painting are bright and vibrant. Now this kind of a chitra was made on a long canvas which is worked like a patta, and that's why that is known as patta chitra. That is known as patta chitra. A huge canvas will be there and the set of painting will be made over there, which will be colored using a natural dyes, and the color used in the painting are brightly and vibrant. Brightly and vibrant means that will be eye catching colors we will be using in that kind of a painting, that is patta chitra. Now we'll come to next. Now these painting refer to work of art executed in tiny size and great detail. Now these are mainly associated with the state of Rajasthan where they are still in practice. Now these paintings reflects the life of Rajputana traditions. That is miniature. Fine, ये that one is miniature. ऊपर वाला जो है that is your patta chitra. And miniature painting. Miniature painting. This painting is known as miniature painting. and this work of art executed in tiny size and great deals. These are mainly associated with the state of Rajasthan, where they are still in practice. Now, these paintings reflect the lifestyle of Rajputana tradition. Now, we'll come to next picture. That is miniature painting. Now, the style of painting is a unique blend of Indian, Persian and Islamic style. Now, it emerged, developed and spread things the period of the Mughals. Now, humans, plants and animals are realistically depicted in this form of art. That is Mughal. That this style of painting is a unique blend of Indian, Persian and Islamic style. It emerged, developed and spread during the period of Mughals. Now, humans, plants and animals are realistically depicted in this form of art. So, Mughals, they were using this unique blend of Indian, Persian and Islamic styles. So, it emerged, developed and spread during the period of the Mughals. Now, humans, plants and animals are realistically depicted in this form of art. So, that is quite clear. I hope all these content about what are the different traditional art form of India. So, that chapter we have revised just now. I hope there is no doubt. If you have a doubt, we are going to discuss this chapter in our maths, in our GK class also. So, fine children. So students, as you all are aware that we were doing revision of your GK book and already we have revised few of the chapters. Next is unit 4, that is Union Territories. Now children, there are 28 states and 9 Union Territories in India. Now earlier we have 29 states, but now Jammu and Kashmir became a union territory. So now here the number of states will be 28 states and 9 union territories. Now the states have their own elected government, whereas the union territories are ruled directly by the union government or the central government. Means whatever will be happen in union territory, that will be took up by a central government. Now, what do you mean by state government and central government? So, first of all, I'll talk about state government. State government means when we were talking about the government which was owned by the state. For example, a state is having a chief minister, just like that in central government we have our prime minister. In the same case, from our that state government we have a chief minister, and that chief minister combined with that cabinet ministry also a set of peoples, those who rule or those who defined all the rules among the cabinet. So, they were ruling our state government, as well as this same kind of format we will having with a central government. Now, if I will talk about our state, we will take an example of our state and then we are going to understand about state government and central government. Central government is same for all, like in central government we have our prime minister, then we have a cabinet ministry also, and they have like central minister of railways, central minister of finance, central minister of that is for that cloth and product industries, So they all are central minister, but with that only we have state minister also, state railway ministers, state industry ministers, state agriculture minister, and these state minister are taking care of their states only. Like whosoever will be railway minister of our state, they are going to take care of their state only. They are going to take care of Uttar Pradesh only. But the centralized railway minister is going to make rule for the whole country. So they were governing their state government and they will be ruled by it. But union territories directly comes in the rule of central government. There we have there we do not have chief minister, there we have only governor uprajyapal. They are known as uprajyapal. Fine, they were only we were having. Now here we will be having, can you identify the union territories discussed below? Now for the first one is, these are a group of islands at the juncture of the Bay of Bengal and Andaman Sea. Cellular Jail and Mahatma Gandhi Marine National Park are some of their major tourist attraction. Now here you can see in the picture, now I think this first picture was quite clear, Andaman and Nicobar Island. Now few of the important tourist attractions we have seen, Andaman and Nicobar Island. Earlier it was known as a Kalapani also. If anyone want to give punishment, they were kept over there. Or this cellular jail was quite famous. This cellular jail where Mahatma Gandhi was kept also. So Mahatma Gandhi Marine National Park is also quite famous over there. These are the few major tourist attractions. But nowadays Andaman and Nicobar, the people are not keeping over there because that island is, as you all are knowing, the verbal meaning of island means a piece of a land which is covered with water. So if we are not going to carry anything over there, we do not, after some time we do not have anything to eat over there, to drink over there. That's why it is known as a Kalapani, as a punishment area, that they will not be provided with anyone, anything. So that is there. So that is again an important thing, that these are a group of islands. And you know that is about 53 to 54 islands were there in Andaman and Nicobar. Small islands were there. And capital of Andaman and Nicobar Island is Port Blair. Capital of Andaman and Nicobar Island is Port Blair. Now we'll come to next. Now the next one is number 2. This park is quite famous park. That is that all the this structures were made up of stones. Fine. And rock garden. This is known as rock garden, and it is quite a famous rock garden from a union territory. Can you name that union territory? That is union territory, that is where you will find it out. This rock garden is Chandigarh. Now it serves as the capital of the two states, Punjab and Haryana. This you all were knowing it also. Now first important thing, it was the first planned city of India, and it is known internationally for its architecture and urban design. Urban design means the how the width of a road is decided, a proper width of a road, proper houses, proper that water treatment plants and water sanitary, or everything was keep it in their minds, and then this union territory was designed. If you will went to Chandigarh, you just find it out that a proper spacing between the houses, they were constructed in a same pattern. Amount of, now here if you will go now, you will find it out that they are making of their own design, but there the that pattern of designing the houses, that is same for each, and they have to leave some area in front of it and they have to leave some area at their back also, backyard also. So they will be having such kind of a structure. So Chandigarh is the Union Territory which serves as a capital for two states, that is Punjab and Haryana. Let's come to the third picture, that is third picture. You can see this third picture. It is an Union Territory in Western India. These are two places included in this Union Territory. The first place is located between Maharashtra and Gujarat, whereas the second place is surrounded by Gujarat. Their shared capital is Silvassa, that is Dadar and Nagar Haveli. Dadar and Nagar Haveli, these are two places. First place is located between Maharashtra and Gujarat, and whereas the second place is surrounded by Gujarat, fine, and they have their shared capital. Dadar and Nagar Haveli, they are two places, but they are sharing a common capital, that is Silvassa. Silvassa is their common capital. So that also you are going to remember, and I hope that is clear to you all. Now we'll come to number 4. Mostly these area, Dadar and Nagar Haveli, is famous for their ship. They are getting most of their work done by ships only. Most of the people came at Dadar and Nagar Haveli by ships. So that those ships are quite important for them. Now we'll come to fourth picture. For over 450 years, both the places here were a part of Portuguese occupied India. For over 450 years, that is very important, 450 years, both the places, Daman and Diu, both the places were a part of Portuguese. Portuguese came in our country before Britishers, and earlier they were ruling different parts of our country, not only this Goan part and all, they were ruling some part from a northeast also and southern part also. But when Britishers have came, then Britishers started fighting with Portuguese. When that the First World War, which was started, not only that First World War, before that, the war which was started in 17 something, in other part of America, that at that same time that impact came here in India also. So in 1750 or 1741 to 45. When the war was beginning over there only, then at that time they were fighting here also, they were in that mood only here also in India. And then Britishers started capturing the areas which was occupied by Portuguese, and lastly Portuguese were limited till Goa only. And they have ruled Goa, even Daman and Diu also, for about 450 years. Later on, they have left Daman and Diu also. But Goa got its independence. Goa got its independence in 1965. Goa is, when our country got independence, Goa was still in the slavery of Portuguese people, and our Goa got his freedom, its freedom in the year 1965, 31st December 1965. So, after that Portuguese went to their country, and then Goa came in the country or came in the rule of Indian government. So, this now see, they were incorporated into the Republic of India on 19 December 1961 by military conquest. See this Daman and Diu. Now, we will come to fifth picture. Fifth picture is, it was formerly known as the Minicoy and Aminidivi Islands. Now, it is a group of islands that is about 200 to 440 kilometers off the southwestern coast of India, forming the smallest union territory. Now, this is the smallest union territory, that is Lakshadweep. Lakshadweep is the smallest union territory, and they occupy about 200 to 440 kilometers of the southwestern coast of India. So, that is again an important thing, that smallest union territory it is formed, and that is Lakshadweep. Minicoy, earlier the formerly known name is Minicoy or Amindiv Islands. Now, we will come to sixth picture. It is one of the most populous city. Populous means most of the population is quite high. It has served as the capital of India, various kingdom and empires, capital of India, as well as it serves as the capital of various kingdoms and empires. They all want to rule Delhi. Even the Muslim emperor, most of the Muslim emperor, they want to rule Delhi, and that Delhi will become sultanate for many of the Muslim rulers. So, New Delhi is well known for its culture. The Muslim emperor and different emperor, not only Muslim, Rajput emperor and many more, they have ruled Delhi, and they have given lot of architect, lot of culture to New Delhi. We found many monument in New Delhi. We found Red Fort, we found Qutub Minar. All these architecture was well known from the government, from the rulers, those who have their kingdom over there. So, they have made lot many architecture in that. Okay, now the seventh one is, the Union Territory comprises of four small unconnected districts. In 1674, it became a French colonial possession. In 1954, it was included in the territory of India. It was the residence of Sri Aurobindo, whose ashram still operates from here. That is Puducherry. The Union Territory comprises of four small unconnected districts. In 1674, it became a French colony position. In 1954, it was included in the territory of India. It was the resident of Sri Aurobindo, whose ashram still operates from here. That is known as Puducherry. Now, Puducherry, in 1674, it became a French colonial position, but they have included in our territory of India in the year 1954. Now, the eighth picture is of are Jammu and Kashmir, which was recently become Union Territory. On 5th August 2019, the government dissolved Article 370. This is very important that on 5th August 2019, the government dissolved Article 370 of the Constitution of India, bifurcated the states into two union territories and notified that this UT shall now be a union territory with its own legislature, similar to how Puducherry and Delhi are administrated. In the case of this union territory, it will be self-administered government with a legislature. What do you mean by legislature? Legislature means their own cabinet ministry, their own self-government that will be formed. And on 5th August 2019, the government dissolved this Article 370, and then this Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, these two, Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, two union territories will be formed. So, before that we have seven, but after forming this Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, now the total number of union territory is 9. Now, this union territory was carved out of the former state of Jammu and Kashmir on 5th August 2019. Now, it is sparsely populated with a very difficult terrain. Now, this UT will be without a legislature. Means that legislature is not there, they were governing by the central government and they are going to form by that self-administered government. They are not form their own government, they will be governed by the central government only. So, carved out of former state of Jammu Kashmir on 5th August 2019 and it is sparsely populated with a very difficult terrain, this UT will be without a legislature.